Good morning for people who in the West Coast. Good evening for people somewhere else. It's a great pleasure to be here with you talking about this very specific sort of theme, the dialectical categories, the more mathematical version. And I am hoping that this thing is going to start. So I think I want to start by thanking Vlad again for keeping the BACAT going. BACAT is the Bay Area Categories and Types, the meetup that Vlad has been organizing for quite a few years now. And I wish I had a better photo of you, Vlad. I think next time I'm going to ask you for a better photo because this one is, it's nice because it's colored by the bay, but it's just kind of a little bit pixelated. And I was going to explain that this talk is very much a repeat of something that I talked about in June. And the audience in June was very different. The audience in June were kind of students. And I wish you would kind of put yourselves in their shoes and think to about yourselves as just back to the days where you were first starting doing any kind of more exciting mathematics and kind of that you just kind of do the calculations with me or kind of went over the calculations with me. But I'm not going to try to do much in terms of motivations and applications and where we're going with these things. So as I was saying, it was a talk given for Andres Villavicis is students in Bogota, Colombia, and they are doing something quite nice because the students are building up a model of mathematics. And I'm kind of very, very proud of the fact that they invited me to talk to them because that I do not know how they are going to put this kind of work in their map of, I mean, in particular, they do model theory with categorical tools. So kind of, I'm very curious to see how they are going to add this stuff. But, you know, they also had this mind frame of just kind of doing the mathematics and seeing where it leads you. And that's the kind of thing that I'm asking you to have today. So for people who don't know me, the students didn't. So that's me as a little girl in Brazil. And that's the place that I come from in Brazil, the Pontifical University Catholic of Rio. And I was talking to Sergei a minute ago, I've given several talks in the BACAT. And I think everyone that has been to these talks knows about that, but these are people that are kind of in my mathematical genealogy. And the person to the left is Martin Highland, who was my supervisor. And the person to the person to the right is Alan Turing. I hope everyone recognizes his face. And lots of people don't know about the person in the middle, who's Robin Gandhi. And I always kind of like to make a bit of a joke about it because Robin was the only PhD student of Alan Turing. And because of that, and because some of those maps that people do in the internet about thinkers and their spheres of influence and stuff like that, at some stage someone cut people who had less than two or three PhD students, and then without noticing, they cut Alan Turing altogether because Alan only had this this PhD student who actually did extremely interesting and important work on recursion theory and other stuff. But we're not talking about them today, so I'm just kind of making the joke or making the observation that this area that we deal with of trying to do things that are both mathematical and kind of related to computing, it's a little bit of a dangerous area. Things kind of, we have to pay attention. So today I want to tell you all about dialectical categories. So I want to talk about the first dialectical category, which because of lack of imagination is called D for dialectical and C because any category is called C. So that is a parametric construction on category C. And the other thing is, please feel free to ask questions about the calculations or whatever kind of, you feel like asking questions, except about kind of where we're going with this stuff, because that we can discuss at the end. As Vlad was saying, we don't have problems with times and stuff. So kind of we can always discuss that as much as you want at the end. But let's kind of try to get the mathematics done. The second bit that I want to talk about is the co-free monoidal comonad that makes DC an interesting model of linear logic. And then I want to talk to you about the dialectical category GC. And GC was suggested to me by Jean-Yves Girard, hence the G. And I'm not very good at names and kind of things like that. And then I want to finish talking about the composite meaning, a monoidal comonad that we get, which is the composite of two different comonads, and that makes GC an interesting model as well. So this is the thesis, and as I said, the thesis is in the I posted that on the abstract, so everyone can look at it and play with the interesting bits. And I was thinking that maybe I should set up an online errata for it, because you know, whenever I open the thesis in any page whatsoever, I always find a new mistake. So it's kind of would be good to keep all of it in a single place. There's kind of billions of mistakes there. And it's not a very well written thesis, I'm afraid. I actually only, I only kind of really written down the mathematics itself that I was trying to do. And I didn't kind of, not being a very good person with deadlines and milestones and things like that, I didn't manage to leave some time for reading the thing over and thinking about how to better present it. So it's very much a very dry style of kind of definition, lemma, theorem. And there's only four theorems really. So kind of you don't have to be too worried. So it's four chapters and four theorems, should be easy. Even I can keep that in my head, I think. But you know, I was going to say, but at least very recently, I had someone that I think is a very, very bright proof theorist telling me that he actually read my thesis when he was starting his PhD, and that actually that convinced him to do categorical proof theory. So I'm I was very, very pleased and moved by this introduction. I thought it was best not to ask if it was because it was such a piece of rubbish that he said to himself that he could do better, or if it was really the way he was saying that he actually liked it so much that he thought he was going to do it. So, but you know, it's better not to ask too much on along those lines. So let's go to the dialectica itself. As you can see, the plan is in the plan of this talk is on top of each slide, and you can see there that we want to talk about the dialectica and the four chapters: the dialectica, the first comonad, the GC, the second comonad, and conclusions. Right. So, Gödel's dialectic interpretation is a very interesting thing, and Gödel was very perfectionist about it. So when he died in 76 or 78, he was still working on better explaining what he wanted to do with it. And one part of it, the dialectic consists of two parts: the system T of finite functionals, and the transformation or the dialectic interpretation bit itself. And the bit about system T became kind of very famous. Everyone hears about that. It's in the proofs and types, the book, the Girard book that does lots of this, lots of people kind of interested in this area kind of know as you know, the good way to get introduced to Curry Howard and things like that. And it's used for all sorts of things in proof theory. But the dialectic itself is much less known. So as I was saying, it consists of two bits, the system T and the transformation. And the transformation itself is much less well known. What it does is kind of try to get rid of the alternation of quantifiers in his case, in higher order logic, Heitian arithmetic, by transforming all formulas into formulas of a very specific shape, which is a shape that exists something for all something, and then the new formula, the dialectical translation of the formula, which I'm now writing A sub D X Y. And my thesis is a categorical, but an internal version of this interpretation. The internal there is because there is an earlier work of Phil Scott that does an external version where you just think about the formulae as really syntactic objects. Mine is internal in the sense that what we want to see is the structure that makes the dialectica an interesting piece of mathematics, a piece of category theory that that explains things. And the bit about the four chapters, four main theorems, I mentioned it already. So the main thing that we'll need from the dialectica, and you can read about it in Wikipedia, in an article that I asked Paulo Oliva to write. You can read the definition of the translation itself, and it, you know, does nothing to atomic formulas, does the obvious things to conjunction, distributes over the sides of the conjunction, does the reasonable thing for if you're thinking constructively about disjunction, which is, you know, take this if it's a left conjunction, you create an extra guard, right? And if this guard is zero, then you go to the left of the disjunction. And if the guard is one, you go to the right of the disjunction. And the most important bit is the one in red there, which is, says what we do with an implication. And what we do with an implication is that we have to take two things of the form that exist an X for all Y, or and the other side there exists a U for X for all V, and you have to transform it into a single thing of this shape that exists something for all something. And what the way we'll do that is by introducing this higher order functionals that work on the variables of the original formulae, and then kind of give you one of these new things. And the thing that is very surprising for category theorists when they look at that is that, you know, everyone knows that if you're dealing with an implication, what you want to do is look at the antecedent and apply something to this antecedent to get something in the consequent. And that's what this g of x, the red g of x is doing, is kind of saying, okay, I'm going to take an x and apply some g that I don't, that some sort of proof of the implication, and then I'm going to get the b of this g of x. But what the dialectica has that it's very different is this f of x w there, because what that does is that it uses something on the place where I want to get to the B, and in the and something from the place that I'm starting from, which is the A, and gives me back something in the A. And this is very exciting, and people have been rediscovering it in terms of lenses, and there's many talks about that one could try to give, but this is not what we're doing today. Today we're just kind of sticking to the stuff that happened 30 years ago, just kind of going over the calculations of 30 years ago. So the theorem, the Gödel theorem from 1958, is that whenever a formula A is provable in Heiting arithmetic, then there exists a sequence of closed terms T such that the formula without quantifiers, so the dialectical version of the formula applied to this term T, is provable in system T. And the sequence of terms T in the proof of AGTY is constructed from the group given proof of A in Heiting arithmetic. So, you know, what we're saying is that we transform formulas of general shape into formulae of this very specific shape. This exists for all A sub D shape, and that we actually can do that using this function of T from system T, and that the proof that I have of a formula, so the only thing that we have for the dialectic is soundness, right? So what we say is that this transformation is sound. It takes sound proofs in Heiting arithmetic and makes them into proofs of the higher order.
Valeria, can I just ask you a question here?
Sure, please.
So is there some of these have X, Y, but some others have many terms and semicolon and many other terms. Mm-hmm. So do you allow any number of them?
No.
It's not just X, Y, it can be X1, X2, X3, Y1, Y2, no, Y3. No.
The things here, some of the things here could have a little arrow on top, because some of the variables, I mean, you can have as many variables in higher order arithmetic as you wish. But what we're looking at is just we are only concentrating ourselves in this, for this talk, in the things that are the two quantifiers that we are transforming the formula to. So the rest we just kind of keep carrying it around as context things. So, you know, here everything should have each formula here should have two elements only, X, Y.
Okay. And also in the soundness theorem, there's a sequence of closed terms, not just one.
Correct.
So that means you have more than one T in there, or is it?
That's correct. And, you know, as I was saying, we are not going to be working here with the system T itself. We are only going to work with this transformation that happens before you do things in the system T. So, you know, we are not kind of concerned at all with, we think that the bit that Gödel does with the system T is all hunky-dory and it's going to happen the way he did it. So what we are kind of trying to say to ourselves is, if we want to understand, let me kind of rephrase it a little bit more. We want to understand how one could, I mean, this is part of Hilbert's program of trying to translate kind of higher kinds of logic into logic that's understandable by people like you and me. And so what Gödel was saying is that, you know, I have this method here, which will transform things into things that are kind of getting closer to my kind of stuff, his kind of stuff, which is first order logic plus this notion of iteration that comes in system T. And what he didn't write anywhere, but the commentators write, is that he wanted to do that in the way that was as constructive as possible, and that he wanted to make it to use as much as of the constructive tools as he could, but there are certain bits that he couldn't do it. And these, and what we are trying to do with the categorical logic stuff is understand that part of the proof, the part of the proof that explains how you can transform the whole universe of higher order Heitian arithmetic into formula of this particular shape, existing U for all X, A dx, UX, and so, you know, it's this process of kind of transforming formulas, generic formulas, into formulas of this shape that the categorical modeling here is about. Is that better?
Yeah, thank you.
Great. So, I'm going to repeat this a few times, but, you know, it is important to try to understand which bit we are attacking, which bit of the problem we are attacking. So as I was saying, the interpretation side of the dialectica is an interpretation of intuitionistic arithmetic in a quantifier-free theory of functions of finite type. And we translate every formula A of Heitian's arithmetic into something of the shape exists U for all X, A, D, X, where there's no more U's and X's. There's no more quantifiers. There is, of course, U's and X's, sorry. I mean, it's quantifier free. And if Heitian arithmetic proves A, then system T.
Please hold.
What? I don't know. Yeah. I think that's Zoom speaking. So let's carry on. Then system T proves the version quantifier free. And I said T is a suitable sequence of terms not containing Y. And that's the use of the dialectica. And the goal was to be as constructive as possible, but we also want to interpret all of classical arithmetic. And there's a very important philosophical discussion here of how much this whole procedure attains, how much philosophically this is a simplification of things or not. And this is needs to be in another talk and must be given by someone else because it's not something that I know enough about. But Troster, for instance, has written quite a bit about it and kind of there's lots in the collected works of Gödel, there's lots about the philosophical discussion of whether this is a useful way of carry on with Hilbert's program or not. So what we want to discuss here is something different. We want to discuss categorical proof theory, which I take to be this kind of connection between category theory, proof theory, and functional programming, this famous triangle that is connected by bijective relations. So, and as I hope everyone in this audience knows, but types are formulae or objects in the appropriate category, terms are programs, terms or programs are proofs and morphisms in the category. And the logical constructors are the appropriate categorical constructions that make the rules be interpreted in a sensible way. And as I keep repeating, the most important bit ever on this triangle is that reduction is proof normalization. So when you're reducing lambda terms, you are normalizing the proof in natural deduction. And when you manage to get all of these things working the way they should, then we have this outcome of being able to transfer results and tools from logic to category theory, from category theory to computer science, from category theory to logic. And this is very pretty and very useful. And the traditional version is the one that is described in the Lambeck-Scott book from 1986, which relates Cartesian closed categories to simply types lambda calculus and to intuitionistic propositional logic as defined by Pravitz. So in the version that's in natural deduction and not the sequent calculus version. And kind of the thing, this is most, the triangle as described here is about propositional intuitionistic logic, but Lovier kind of was able to do it for the same ways as Pravitz did it for quantifiers. The Lovier did the categorical modeling for quantifiers. So we are kind of restricting ourselves to the version in propositional logic. And then kind of we want to talk a little bit about linear logic, but I wanted to make sure that, I mean, as I was saying, I don't mind kind of going back to the discussion about what you can do and can't do with the sequence T of terms in system T, capital T. But I think we need to, and I think the philosophical discussion here is also a very interesting one, but I think we should do it once we get to the end of the pure bits of mathematics, which are about to start, I hope. So before they start, another two slides quickly about linear logic. So the basic idea of linear logic is that assumptions cannot be discarded or duplicated. They must be used exactly once, just like dollar bills. And there were lots of other approaches to accounting for logical resources before. But the great win of linear logic, as far as I'm concerned, is that the accounting for resources happens if you want to look at them. Otherwise, you can just fall back on traditional logic because in the same system, because you have this translation that says that A implies B intuitionistically or classically, if and only if you have this modality bang that applies to A, and that so you divide the implication, which is the lambda that we all like so much, into two more primitive operations, this linear implication, which is a subcase of the implication, and this more complicated notion of bang or shriek, or of course, that tells you where you need to duplicate things or where you need to erase them for that particular kind of implication. And as I was saying, kind of Martin Hyland suggested that we should look at a categorical model of the dialectical interpretation, and that we should look at the functions corresponding to the interpretation of logical implication. And I looked, and instead of finding a Cartesian closed category, which we are all expecting, including Dana Scott, who was there for the presentation, we actually found simply a monoidal closed category. And you know, I would kind of not be able to realize that that was actually a good result. I thought was a bad result, that I couldn't provide a Cartesian closed category. But Martin looked around and said, oh, that's nice. There's this guy, this French guy, who's talking about something new called linear logic. And I think that means something interesting. And that's how the work on the thesis developed, because the categories in the thesis proved to be models of linear logic. And in some ways, because the name of Gödel carries such a weight, it was a very good thing for linear logic that these models were kind of introduced so early on and kind of was a seal of approval to this kind of logic. I think people tend to say bash around these slogans about linear logic that what is good about it is that it has the symmetries of classical logic plus the constructive content of intuitionistic logic. And as most slogans, there's some truth to it, but I don't know if it's the full truth. So hope people have seen this stuff, and I don't have to use an awful lot of time, but I wanted to remind you quickly of what we mean by these resources, thinking of assumptions and conclusions as resources. So, you know, if you had silly things like, with $1 I can get a latte, and if $1 I can get a cappuccino, and I have only $1, I cannot have a latte and a cappuccino. I can only have one of the two. And so it's this notion of the linear implication in this case, in the case that I have a dollar and I could choose one of the two, it will give me, say, a latte, but the dollar is gone. I don't have it anymore. And that's kind of, usual logic is very different from that, right? Because in usual logic, we don't pay attention to uses of premises. So A implies B and A will give me a B, but I still have an A and I can still have it in several other bits of my proof if that's just the top of what I'm doing. So because of that, we start writing the implication, the linear implication with this lollipop, and that will kind of mean this notion that assumptions are used in a proof and then disappear. It will give us kind of two different notions of conjunction. The linear conjunction is the one where we cannot discard the premise, and the traditional conjunction, we can do that, but the traditional conjunction and traditional disjunction just kind of live there side by side. They are called the additives, and we don't kind of, we're not so impressed with them. We're only going to concentrate on what I think is the heart of the linear logic system, which is the multiplicatives and the explanations. And of course, the operator, of course, is the thing that is mathematically the hardest thing to model. So we kind of, what we need from it is that it allows you duplication and allows you discarding. So and we'll see much more about it in a minute. So far, so good. We had kind of intuitionistic logic, and we kind of said, we just kind of use our elders and betters to say, well, and we have this beautiful triangle relating simply type lambda calculus to categories and to logic, to Private's kind of natural deduction. And now we kind of talked about Girard and talked about the fact that he had this other logic that seems to be underlying intuitionistic logic, because it has more primitive operators perhaps than the ones of intuitionistic logic. And then you can say, and I was telling you already that I was doing modeling of things that should have been Cartesian closed categories, and they were not, they were kind of monoidal closed. And so, you know, why do I say that is modeling linear logic, and what were the challenges of modeling linear logic? Well, you see, 30 years later, people kind of are very, aware of the idea that they are real Cartesian products and they are tensor products, and there are many more tensor products than Cartesian products. But 30 years ago, things were different. Mathematicians were kind of playing with these things, and they had quite a few examples of things that were real products. Real products were kind of the main name of the game. And people knew that you could think about tensor products, but they didn't kind of pay much attention to them. They were much less important than they are nowadays. And but on the other hand, kind of bit like people knew about intuitionistic logic before there were Cartesian closed categories or toposes. But topos is kind of being discovered by the algebraic geometers and used by them, kind of made lots of mathematicians who couldn't care less about the difference between intuitionistic logic and classical logic. You know, the fact that the internal logic of a topos is intuitionistic or constructive made lots of mathematicians pay attention and say, well, yeah, kind of maybe we should at least keep tabs, keep checking if things are requiring classical reasoning or not, because it was considered a big kind of evidence for the fact that intuitionistic or constructive logic is a serious kind of logic. So the problem with modeling linear logic is that when we are dealing with these implications that eat up the antecedent and we kind of, instead of having the traditional sets of functions from A to B that people normally write as B to the A, as in the second line there, we will have to have a notion of internal home in category theory. And instead of having real products which have projections and have duplication built in, duplication is diagonals in the category, these things are not linear. So we will need to change them. But that's kind of something that the category theorists had done before. So it was not so hard because, you know, there was the category theorists, always the mathematicians in general, but in particular, the category theorists tend to think about things they try to think about things as generalizable as it's sensible. So they had done this stuff in, you know, I was writing this in 1988, and in 68, they had done these calculations to have tensor products and internal homes and symmetric monoid closed categories defined and proved the properties of. What was hard for me was this business of how to define the make everything usual again operator, the Pling, of course. And so finally, we started the bits of mathematics that I want you to play with. So you started with a category C that's Cartesian closed with some other nice properties. And we will discuss these other properties at some stage. But you know, by and large, I'm thinking of sets. So just stick to sets. And we'll build a new category called DC. And the objects of this new category are relations. That is, they are triples. Two sets, U and X, and a relation alpha. And in the level of category theory that we're talking about here, there are two ways of dealing with relations, right? One more trivial way is to say that alpha takes pairs of U. I mean, the category is Cartesian closed, so you know, it has products. So I can think about pairs U and X and map them into two, the object that corresponds to true and false. So either the relation alpha relates little u and little x or not. And I can do that either using sub-objects or using this maps into two. And there are kind of pros and cons for each one of these two different ways of modeling things. And when I did the first version, the first two chapters of the thesis, I used sub-objects instead of using those maps. But at this level, they are equivalent. But it's one of the things that one needs to think that this many years later, what we gain and what we lose by choosing these things. And that's an observation that a student in this year, ACT, made when we're discussing an application of this stuff to Petri nets. And so the objects are very trivial. There's loads and loads of categories of relations in mathematics. There's books, whole books, like the book of Peter Fried and Andrei Shedrov written about it. But the thing that's very specific to the Dialectica categories is the collections of maps. As I was mentioning before, a map here between a UX alpha and a VY beta is going to be a pair of maps, in our case in sets, and a little f that goes from u to v, and a capital F that goes from u cross y back into x. And not only we have this funny kinds of going in one direction and going backwards in the other direction, but also there is a semi-adjunction condition that is satisfied. And this semi-adjunction condition is very much constructive in itself, because it says that for each u and u, and for each y and y, if we have that u alphas f of u y, then we have the little f applied to u betas y. And so in red there, you see the implies. And if you have tried to do things with, if you have played with two spaces, for instance, you see that there is a, instead of an implies, there is an if and only if, and they are similar from this perspective, but very different in terms of the structures that happen to arise from this structure, from this category. So in 1987, that many years ago, I kind of proved this thing that the category DC has a symmetric monodal closed structure with products and weak co-products, and that's a model of exponential free intuitionistic linear logic. And that's theorem 104. Hang on to that. The fact that these morphisms are so different from traditional category theory says that we have to do some work to prove that this is indeed a category. And that is because, of course, things in the first, you know, you have to be thinking to yourself that the things are pairs, you know, they are triples, in fact, because there's a u and x and the alpha, but the alpha can sit between u and x. And so you think about the world of those objects as consisting of two main parts, the left-hand side and the right-hand side. And the left-hand side behaves the way things normally behave in category theory. So things compose without the way they should, things have diagonals the way they should, they have projections the way they should, they do everything that they should on the left-hand side. But the right-hand side is always trying to disprove this stuff. It's always trying to mess up our hard work. So, and you know, just even providing composition on the right-hand side, you have to think a little bit, not hard enough, but you have to think a little bit, because what you want to compose is
the, please hold.
You want to compose the capital G and the capital F, but as you can see, they don't compose naturally. So what you need to do is you need to duplicate your U, apply the little F on the first, on the second component, then you can apply your G, and then you can apply your F. And you still need to check that the semi-adjunction conditions work. So everything here kind of requires pen, I mean, at least for me, it requires pen and pencil and keeping your head down. So you kind of, by now, feeling fed up and saying, well, can you give me some intuition for these objects? And I would say, well, I'm very incompetent, I cannot. But Andreas Blass was better. And he makes this case for thinking of these objects as problems in, he would think about it as problems in computation, of computational complexity. And I actually am suggesting that we want to think a little bit bigger than that, and to think that you should think about an object of DC as representing a problem, and the elements of U are instances of the problem, the elements of X are possible answers to the problem instances, and the relation alpha says whether the answer is correct for that instance of the problem or not. And then you can look at some examples, right? So, and you can think about kinds of problems that are paradigmatic. For instance, if you had the set of natural numbers n as left-hand side and the right-hand side, and the relation alpha is being just equality, you can have a one problem that's very hard, right? Because, you know, if the relation is, if the only thing that you can get is the the diagonal itself. So, you know, I give you an N and you actually have to give me exactly the same N without knowing what the N was, then this is a hard problem. But if I, but on the other hand, if I give you the N and you can give me anything but that N, you have many more chances than you had before, right? So it's a, it's an easier, at least intuitively, it's a much easier problem. And you can have a, another example, like all the functions from natural numbers to natural numbers and the natural numbers. And then you can do a very surprising sort of relation where you say, well, I will say that my relation is F is alpha related to N, if and only if I can apply F to N and I get N. And then you can do an awful lot of interesting stuff with the real numbers. Like for instance, you can do the semi-plane, half-plane thing there that I'm describing. But the set theorists are doing much more exciting stuff than simply that. And as usual in kind of exciting mathematics, they actually had to invent some extra conditions for themselves because they did not want to think about trivial conditions where there is a solution for all the problems or there is a problem that is one solution for all the problems or a problem that has no solution. So they created extra conditions that are called MHD conditions. These are three set theorists. You can read about it in the website, and it's very exciting because they will use this kind of layered versions of sets. All of these guys, of course, are in D sets, right? Because they're all sets in general. But the set theorists will be using only things less than where the objects have cardinality less than R or whatever they call R, and they kind of will be looking at different cardinalities there, and there's very interesting problems and interesting solutions there. If you are, you can ask me later. And for this category, we have a very obvious tensor product. You know what you do when if you have two triples and you want to do a tensor product of two triples. Well, you just, and you have products all over the place, so you just do the products, right? So you just do U cross V, X cross Y, and alpha cross beta. And this gives you a bifunctor, and you might kind of think to yourself that this is a product, but it isn't, because you don't have projections, for instance. You see, you do have the projection in the first coordinate because U cross V does go to U, but you know, you now need to take an X into an X cross Y, and what do you choose on your Y? There's no obvious thing to choose there. And same thing about the diagonal. You don't have a diagonal because you certainly have a diagonal in the first coordinate. You can just duplicate your U. But then on the second coordinate, you have to take two copies of X and make it into a single copy of X in a uniform and clever way, right? And yes, recursion theorists have a trick here and it can work, but it's not very categorical. And I can talk to you a bit more about it later if you want. So, you know, you have this nice tensor product and you can invent your internal home trying to internalize the notion of map between these problems. So, you know, we had already decided that we believe Gödel. We know that, I mean, we think that the old guy knew what he was doing with his functionals. So we kind of then decided to follow his steps and decide that maps from, and that's what we did so far, right? When we constructed the category DC, we said, okay, let's take the old guy's notion of map. And now, if we want to make something that looks like logic, that satisfies the deduction theorem, and we have a very reasonable notion of conjunction, we can reverse engineer a notion of implication, because, you know, we know that we need functions from U to V, the good, well-behaved ones, and we know that we need functions capital F from U cross Y into X, and, you know, in sets we can write them as the object that I'm writing down there, so kind of V to the U cross X to U cross Y. And then we say to ourselves, yeah, but, you know, we had that implication there in the definition that we wanted to make sure is satisfied. So how do we do that? Well, we better give us places to apply these things, because I need to be able to tell you what happens to the alphas and the betas, right? So I have to give you a pair U, comma Y, where you can apply little f in capital F. And then I have to tell you how to make that that implies work. But I can't tell you how to make the Y implies work, because you know already that implies is a bit like it's contained in, or it's less than equal than, and I mean, it's less than equal in the set two of the truth values. It's kind of contained in if you're thinking of sub-objects. And so what you do is that you construct this this relation beta to the alpha that just internalizes the notion of morphism that we got from Gödel. And that works. So, you know, you get that object over there, which has a complicated first left-hand side of the world and an easy one on the right, and has a complicated notion of relation, but does do everything that you want. It is a bifunctor, it's contravariant in the first coordinate, it's covariant in the second. And most of all, the most important thing, it satisfies the deduction theorem, which is if A and B prove a C, that is if and only if A proves that B implies C. And I'm not going to show this theorem now, because I'm going to show it in the next in chapter 3, where it's simpler. So, but hang on to the fact that we have our first big theorem announced here. And so, yeah, that's the theorem, the linear structure theorem. And this slide is just to show you that the products and co-products that I think are not particularly important in the case of linear logic, but are particularly important for people who like category theory and want to do category theory. It's important to see that we have products that are very reasonable in a way. If you bought Girard's Kool-Aid, if you read his long paper in TCS and believed his reasons for having two kinds of conjunction, then this makes an awful lot of sense, because the product of two objects will have a product in the first coordinate, but a co-product in the second coordinate, because you need to think that a width has a mixed character. It's a bit like a conjunction, but it's also a bit like a disjunction. And this can be seen by the fact that you have this co-product in the second coordinate, which, you know, simplifies some things, because since this is a relation in the set U cross V cross X plus Y, it's either an X comma zero or a Y comma one, And depending on which one it is, you pick the right, the correct relation alpha or beta. So there's no choice to be made at the level of the product. The product already knows who you're going to choose. Now, this is actually very important and has to do with the talk next week, because there is a dual construction that is immediate, right? You could do co-product in the first component and product in the second component, but this does not work in this category at all. You don't even have canonical injections. You only have a notion of a weak co-product, which is not this dual construction. And so kind of hang on to this thought for next week. But we have our first theorem now, that the category DC or D sets has a symmetric monoidal closed structure with real products, weak co-products, and it is a model with exponential free intuitionistic linear logic. Much more interesting, we can create a co-free modality for this category. So we need an operation on objects or propositions. I mean, it is the case that, you know, it's easier to think that on the case of propositions, because we know we need to take assumptions and duplicate them. We need to take an assumption and be able to erase it. We need to take one of these assumptions and say that, you know, if this pling A is something that I can use zero times or as many times as I want, then in particular I should be able to use it once, a single time, which is the third the derived thing there, the dereliction. And also the fourth one, which says that if something is such that I can erase it or duplicate it, then I can add a streak, a pling to it. That's less rule, which sometimes is called promotion, but also for digging. It's actually source of the whole literature on light linear logic, elementary linear logic, and all these things. And I mean, it's very difficult to see which bit has to do with the digging itself and which bit has to do with wanting shriek to be a functor, meaning, you know, category theorists always want that if a function f comma f in this case going from A to B, then if you apply some functor to it, then you'll get something from pling A to pling B. And you know, this is so ingrained in us that only things that should be paid attention to are functors, that it's kind of difficult to see which bit comes from what. And you know, that was really the main important thing for me at that stage in 1987. Only appeared in 1989, but the meeting where I first presented it was in 87. And so the beautiful thing was to say, well, okay, if we take a pling operation, which just takes the free commutative monoid on X on the second quadrant of your object, and you do the obvious thing with the relation, then that will work. That will give you a common ad, satisfying all these 1, 2, 3, 4 properties that we five because you want functor two. And even more beautiful is the fact that actually the proof theorists, actually in this case, proof theorists Diller and Nam had done it and had showed that the dialectica allowed some sort of extension using something like that, where you kind of, instead of giving yourself just one counterexample in each morphism, you give yourself a finite but unbounded possibility of having counterexamples, because that's what the X star does, right? X star is the traditional clean star. So, you know, it's going to give you a finite sequence of elements of X, X1, X2, Xn. And you know, we need commutative guides because because we don't actually all those guys, I mean, you're trying to, this guy should work in different orders somehow, but we're not going to say much about that.
Can I just ask about the previous slide? So I understand that this is a co-monad, but I don't understand why it is monoidal, because I see the arrows pointing the other way. For monoidal, I would expect to have I to bang A and bang A tensor bang A into bang A. It's a monoid, I would expect. But your arrows are pointing the opposite way, as if it were a comonoid.
This is a comonad, not a monad, right?
Yes.
And the thing is, it is a monoidal comonad, meaning that pling A tensor B goes to pling A tensor pling B. So it's got to be monoidal, because you need to be able to use your operation over things that are related by commas on the left hand side. So
but the first, I'm talking about the first two bullets in this slide,
right?
Which are very suggestive that you have actually comonoidal operations.
Well, the result of applying pling is a comonoid. And the difficulty here is that you have to have a comonoid that's also a coalgebra, and these two specific structures of the object have to interact properly.
It's a monoidal, it's still monoidal, it's just a monoidal structure is not shown on this slide.
That's right. The monoidal structure is kind of difficult to show. Monoidal structures is what Robert Seeley kind of used for this stuff, right? It's what people called. Let me rephrase it. The monoidal structure shows up in what's called the Seeley equations for the model. Because what he uses is this idea that that pling A with B, the real product, is the same thing, is isomorphic to pling A tensor pling B. Now, this is a simplification, and then he's using an isomorphism. So it's called a Seeley isomorphism. Now, I have a series of problems with this stuff, because the first problem is that the model can be done without any products around at all, without any adjectives at all. But the model requires that you explain how you are transforming the commas on the left into something on the right. So what you need, the monoidal natural transformation just takes, as I was saying, the pling of a tensor product into tensor product of plings, and it's not showing in the four bullets, because the bullets are about how each object behaves, right? I was trying to give you the intuition of how, if you're just a logician, you could think about this stuff. Whereas if you are just a logician, it's harder to think about, if you're just a logician, you need to think that sequence have an extra operation, which is the comma. And that's what the monoidal does. It transforms commas into operations that are in the category. Is that better?
Yeah, I understand. Thank you.
Not all. So okay, I should have just gone ahead, right? Because I say here that we need to show several propositions. The first one is that pling is a monoidal comonad, so there is a natural transformation transforming, and this first thing here should be a tensor, and it's just miswritten, sorry. Sorry, there should be a round thing here, okay? This is a tensor. And, but as I was saying, each bling induces a commutative commonoid structure on each object bling A. Each bling A also has a natural coalgebra structure induced by the commonad, and the commonoid and coalgebra structures interact in a nice way. And there are plenty of different ways to phrase these conditions. I think, and as I said, I think the more usual nowadays, the way that people are thinking about it is that it's the so-called linear, nonlinear logic style, which is Nick Benton's old thing. And it says that there is a monoidal junction between DC and its co-free, co-Kleisley category for the commonad bling above. And that, I mean, stopping there for this thing was great. Thank you so much, because I was almost forgetting to say something that I find quite important. And I wanted to say it here. So you see, when I had this theorem in 1987, I thought I had a much better theorem than Robert Seeley did, because, you know, not only I actually used everything, I mean, I kind of knew everything that he was saying and actually proved what he proved in his paper in 1987 too, which is what is required for a categorical model. But I also had a specific one, a model that was found in the wild of the mathematical propositions, as opposed to something that was a definition. I mean, because what we've been discussing just this minute is what is required for a model, right? Because we're taking as given the propositions of linear logic, or at least we are just now kind of saying, okay, all, you know, I need each bling A to satisfy duplication. I need each bling A to satisfy erasing. I need each bling A to satisfy the reliction. I need. So I was kind of talking about what is required for something to be a categorical model of linear logic. So I this is kind of where I was extremely stupid in 1988 and or 1987 or thereabouts, because I thought everyone would see that I had not only done everything that Robert done on his paper on the same book, but that I actually had a specific model from real life as opposed to from syntax. Of course, I was totally wrong. And of course, you know, nowadays, not only I have to fight with Google Scholar because they insist that I cannot have two papers called the Dialectica Categories, one which is really just this first two chapters and one that is the whole thesis. So they kind of keep trying to delete things. But also I have much fewer citations than Robert has, less than a half of his citations, because, you know, he was much clearer explaining what a model should be. Whereas, because I actually was doing what I thought was more, well, it is more kind of mathematically speaking, right? Because I'm not only saying what the model ought to be, but I was also saying, oh, look, I have one here, one that I made before. But that made it very confusing and didn't go down well. Kind of. Even Paul André Méliès has many more citations than I have. And a few years later than that, I had a physicist friend of mine saying, "But Valeria, you did all this stuff. Why aren't you complaining about that?" And it's kind of a bit kind of. I mean, I think Shomajid, my physicist friend, was right. I was a bit stupid, but never mind. So, okay. All right, maybe I said it in the wrong place, because here I'm explaining what is the calculation that both me and Robert did to show that this is a model for linear logic. To show that something is, that this thing is a real model for linear logic, you need to show that when you put the plane in, you end up in intuitionistic logic as we know and love it. So what we need to show is this business that, and this product here is the this is the intuitionistic product. And but here, and here we're talking about the implication in the intuitionistic model. So we need to show this natural isomorphism here. And this is just a series of equivalents that were proved before. So you take the product and put in using the fact that we proved that the plink is satisfied. So you put your plane in the first bit, and then you transform it using exactly the monoidal natural transformation that you just mentioned into a plane A tensor, a plane B. And then you use the main theorem that I said I proved for the DC here to move the B to the other side, to the side of the implication. And then it ends up with a plink in here. And this thing, the plink in here is the Kleisley version of the implication. So the internal home in this case. So yes, that's why I'm kind of putting Seeley 1989 in section 2.5 of the thesis here. So this collection of isomorphisms, you know, for me, the important one, the one that I worked very hard to prove, was just the one that goes from here to here, because the others were things that we had agreed needed to be satisfied. Then, so that was cool. I mean, that was a very nice situation in Boulder in 1987. And you know, I was talking to people before the beginning of the conference, and I mentioned what I'd done and as a young PhD student, I was not supposed to talk in the conference. Robert was extremely kind and said, well, I think what you have is better than what I have. Why don't you give your talk and I'll not talk? And so I kind of talked in his place and stuff. And so, you know, was a very difficult thing, because of course I was not prepared to give talks at this stage. And it was my first conference ever and was already an international one. So it was kind of a hard thing. But in this place, in this conference in Boulder, was when Girard kind of came to me and said, well, look, I think that's all very nice, but I can do a better model of linear logic. Why don't you simplify things? You know, get rid of this complicated function that you have coming back and just do a function that goes back directly, like y to x. And keep the rest that you like, so you can keep the implication on the same adjunction condition. So that simplifies the maps considerably. And then you kind of prove the same, and then you prove the same theorem that now the new category GC has a symmetric monoidal closed structure. Now it has products and co-products as you wanted, and it makes it a model of full intuitionistic linear logic or classical linear logic with modalities. And then there's this difficulty here that, you know, but I said, well, but then I don't have the connection with the dialectic anymore. So Girard says, this should be related to Hankin quantifiers, but no one, I mean, I've mentioned it to several people, no one has been able to make a more mathematics out of this simple observation. So, you know, feel free to try to do it yourselves. Now, what's happened here? We simplified the notion of maps. But you know, we will carry on with the same sort of stuff that we were doing before. So we have little f's from U to V and capital S from Y to X. and they satisfy the condition that we had before, that for all u and u, for all y and y, u alphas f of y implies f of u beta y's. And that will give us this object very similar to the one we had before. So we do this whole thing, and we check that we can define a similar sort of relation beta to the alpha, and the dialectic implication condition still holds. So we have an internal home without too much difficulty. And if you remember, for us before, the tensor was easy and the internal home was hard. We had to work on it. Now we have a very easy internal home, but life is never totally easy. So the internal home is very simple, but the tensor product is quite complicated, and people don't like it very much, but it is the thing that works with this particular internal home. And it's completely constructed by reverse engineering. You kind of look at the adjunction that you want to hold, because you know that you want your deduction theorem to hold, and then you kind of see how you can make it so. And you end up with something that, if you look at it, looks interesting and odd. Interesting because you are kind of you're doing a cross product of these things, right? So on one of the objects is u x alpha, the other is v y beta, and instead of having and you know, the left side is good, you just do whatever you always do, which is in this case the product. But the right hand side, now we're going to have other internal homes in the lower category, so in this case, sets of functions, and they go across each other. So, you know, the x used to go into the u, could the v could go into the y, but it doesn't. It goes into the x, and similar for the y to the u. And that also does provide a tensor product in the category. And here I wanted to show you how to calculate this reverse engineering. And I promise that we are getting to the end, but bear with me while we look at it. Because as I keep saying, you know, I hope everyone agrees with me that this is just a deduction theorem, right? The deduction theorem normally says gamma comma A proves B, if and only if gamma proves A arrows B. And this, the gamma is this, I'm just thinking of a single A, but you know, it's a bit similar to what we were doing before. We are kind of, this A could be a collection of things. The important stuff is what's happening to the B and the C. So this was a conjunction proving a C, if and only if I keep the A static and I pass the B to the other side and I have a function from B to C. So, you know, not only this is the deduction theorem, it's a thing that you actually learn in third grade or fourth grade. The idea that you can, if you have a function with two arguments, you can hold one, it's curring and uncurring, you can hold one and pass the other one and make a function with the other one. So over here, it works beautifully because if you, and this is a bad LaTeX thing. One of these days I'm going to get it back to my own old macros, but you know, that just means that this is the left-hand side of the object, this is the right-hand side of the object. And if I have a map from the complicated tensor to a single gamma object, I must have a function from u cross v to w, and I must have, wow, one function from z into this pair. But a function from z into this pair is actually two functions, right? One from z to this guy and one from z to this guy. And just the adjunction on the lower level will get me all, because here I have u cross v to w, and here I need something that goes from u into w to the v. Well, the adjoint of the f will do it. And Here, I need something else that goes from, I mean, I left it empty here just because it was kind of causing trouble with the LaTeXing, but I need something that goes from U into Y to the Z. So that's something that goes from U cross Z into Y. And to go from U cross Z into Y, I just use the G2 bad because I'm adjoining it. And finally, on the other side, I need to use the, I need something that goes from V cross Z into X. And I have something already that goes from Z into X to the V, so I can make it into Z to V into X. And kind of bar commutation of these products, I get it with this G bar, G1 bar. So everything matches miraculously. And they do the same in the other one, which has the complicated tensor product. And that's kind of the fun of the Dialectica categories is that there's nothing left, nothing missing. It just fits it. So with this, doing this small calculation of reversing, I mean, that was not done as in reverse engineering, but was actually kind of created to do that. We get the simplified category GC, which has a symmetric monodal closed structure, and we'll make it a model of full intuitionistic linear logic or classical linear logic without modalities. And this is kind of quite interesting to me, but not to many other people, because this led to this notion of full intuitionistic linear logic where the linear negation does not satisfy, double negation is the same as the thing that you started from. So, you know, it is more intuitionistic than ILLL. And that's still another talk. That one I can give, that's a bit better than the one about system T and the philosophical implications. And then we have another big problem, right? Because, you know, this whole thing only works as a model of linear logic if we can find a bang operator that does the right thing in this one. And for me, that was a very big obstacle because I banged my head against that for quite a while because it's obvious that the monoidal commoner that we had before, the beautiful one, which is just taking the free monoid on the wrong side of the world, on the right-hand side of the world, which means a comonoid in the whole, on the whole of the category, that doesn't work. It doesn't work because we need, as we were discussing before, we need commutative comonoids with respect to the new tensor product. Comonoids are only comonoids with respect to some notion of tensor, right? And the tensor here now is much more complicated. So the previous one doesn't work. So one way to see the conundrum or the difficulty that I had here is that I had one comonad in GC that dealt with the comonoid structure and one comonad that dealt with the coalgebra structure. But I couldn't do with both of them at the same time. And I need that to have a real notion of model. And that's where Thierry Coquin was very, very helpful because he kind of looked at me and said, well, can't you compose them? And I said, yes, I can, but I never thought of that. And I never thought of that because normally comonads don't compose. So it's another one of these bad habits that you can get into is not trying to compose things because they generically don't. But in this case, they do. They are related by distributive laws, both in the monoid side of it and in the comonoid side. And the versions in the monoid side kind of lift up to give distributive laws on the comonoid side, and plenty of calculations gets us there. So we take this new operator called bang, and what we do is we do the comonoid here, and we do this beautiful thing that normally is not a common ad, but because you have to fix the U to have a common ad, but in this case, yes. So you get this object which construct maps from U to X star, and that will be the correct, well, the good common ad to create a model of bank in linear logic in this case. So that's theorem four, and we kind of got over all of them. So conclusions. I introduce you to what I think is an underappreciated dialectical model for linear logic, two actually, DC and GC. DC was the first mathematical co-free model of linear logic, and these models were the first to satisfy all the distinctions that linear logic wanted to make. Some people feel that they are not as good as they should be because GC does satisfy the mixed rule, which means that in this setting, we have that tensor implies the disjunction. So, you know, it's something that is true in intuitionistic logic that A and B does prove A or B. But the mixed rule in linear logic has many, many people who like it and many people who just like it, who think that's wrong. I tried to hint at its importance for the importance of the models for interdisciplinarity, because we are actually mixing up category theory proofs and programs maybe you haven't seen much about the programs here, but there are other places where they show up more. And you know, the main philosophical claim is that these things really work for us in the three areas. And I think much more work is needed on the applications and also in the original motivation. What I mean by that is that there's another part of the use of the dialectica that I didn't discuss with you at all, and I didn't even write in the slides, but it is the bit about what else Gödel needed to make the thing work. You know, it's not enough to have these very clever functionals, was not enough to have a very clever notion of system T. There's also three extra bits that he needed, which are the citability of basic predicates, the independence from premise rule, and Markov's principle. And these two principles, because the citability is different, but the two principles, independence of premise and Markov's principle, are debatable. I was going to say dubious, but it's not dubious. They are debatable. Some constructivists accept them and some do not. So why these things, what is the import of these choices in the constructions that we are discussing is something that I don't know and I wish I knew. But in particular, I think much more work is needed on notions of superpower games, because this objects that we're talking about here, it was clear to everyone from Andreas Blass, even earlier than Andreas Blass, was clear that these things, this categorical construction is a bit like a notion of a superpower game. Because, you know, there is a game happening between things being proved on the left-hand side and things being refuted on the right-hand side. But it's not like we actually engage on the game. It's a bit more like I say, that's what I'm going to do on this case. And you say, and that's how I'm going to reply. And we look only at the strategies and we kind of decide who wins the game, who won the game, if someone did win the game, which is not necessarily the case. So there's a notion of superpower games that everyone can see is somehow built in here, but that would be nice to kind of see how it connects to some of the other notions of games in the literature. So take home, working in this in kinds of interdisciplinary areas is hard, but rewarding. This frontier between logic, computing, linguistics, and categories can be a fun place to be, but can be also a hard one to be. Whenever you do things that are interdisciplinary, kind of everyone always thinks that their side of the interdisciplinarity is totally trivial. So kind of always hard to convince people that there is something happening. Mathematics teaches you a way of thinking more than specific theorems, and I think that we all agree it's not a big deal. I think there's lots of barriers to our to development of the things that we want to develop, and one of them is over-specialization, kind of people like me being incompetent at talking to people in the ways that they understand. But lots of other more institutionalized barriers, like lack of open access, which cause lots of trouble, unwillingness in people in computing, for instance, to waste time on formalizations. There's lots of difficulties happening there. But there's lots of enablers too, right? We have international scientific communities kind of getting together. There's open access and open software, growing open source logic software and growing interaction perhaps between fields. So that's it. And I'm sorry that I took so long. Thank you.
Thank you, Valeria. Okay. Well, I was listening and seeing that these things are actually pretty much implementable. I started thinking, can you have it in the code? Did you ever try it?
No, I have not even tried, but there's code for two spaces, right? There's a Java calculator for two spaces, mm-hmm. using very small sets, right? Because you see, one of the things that I talked about was this business that the set theorists want to do that only with big infinites, right? One of the things that they say is that they don't want to think about smaller sets. They want to think only about things that are between natural numbers and the reals. But for people who are trying to do the logic of that, then it makes lots of sense to do things with sets that are, first of all, to have the constants of linear logic, you have to have empty sets and one sets and stuff. And let me stop sharing because and see people's face. So there's, it's possible to do, for people who are doing logic, it makes lots of sense to think about smaller sets. And at the moment I'm doing with the guys from the applied category theory, we're doing things using this kind of setup. We're doing it for petri-nets because petri-nets can be done using Dialectica categories, and they there you want to kind of calculate with 2 and 3 and 4 and 25 or something, but it doesn't exist yet as a any kind of implementation.
Yeah, well, actually, larger sets are not as hard to have in the code. You just cannot list all the elements. Like I have LF1 in my model of ZFC, so yeah, it's doable.
Well, then we should kind of, because there's an awful lot of extra new stuff happening there that I would like to see implemented. There's this, I'm going to mention now something that is work that has not been done yet, but you know, that we hope to do one of these days. Some of it has been done. There's something called the Chichon diagram. Have you seen that? It's in Wikipedia. You can check. Let me type in the chat for you. You might enjoy it. If you type that in Wikipedia, you're going to see what the diagram is. And what mm-hmm. the diagram says is that if the continuous hypothesis is false, meaning there's lots of things between 2 to the n and the reals in some sense, then you have lots of cardinalities that people mm-hmm. have considered via topology and that are related by less than equals. And one of the things that Peter Voces kind of did was to show that some of them can be proved just using the morphisms of the category. So, you know, most of them can be shown, there's one missing, most of them can be shown using just the existence of a dialectical morphism. And, you know, it's a completely, and that one is miraculous because it's a completely unrelated, as far as I can tell, application of the idea of dialectica, right?
I wanted to ask something related, actually.
Hi?
Previously you had a talk about term assignments. Is this not a different model than that? So there, what is the relation between this, what you just presented, and the terms that you presented some years before? Is that, are they completely different? Because when you want to implement something, then you need to make a choice if they're not the same.
Right. No, I have, there are terms that are implemented in AGDA, to show that full intuitionistic linear logic satisfies cut elimination. And I'm very proud of that. That's Harley Eads' work with me. And so the point there was just show that the logic made sense. What we're talking about now is actually go inside and look at different things that we can prove in the model, right? I think that's, at least that's how I understood Vlad's question. So, you know, yes, all the work on term assignment that I mentioned to you before, it all agrees with that. It all kind of, the things happen at the same time. They're not unconnected, but the work on term assignments is, as I was saying, it's more similar to Robert Seeley's work, because it's about the work in term assignments is saying, well, what do I need to make this work? And these terms and these reduction rules are the bare minimum that I need to make things work. What is this stuff here? It's different because it is about things that happen in mathematics by themselves. So, you know, those things would exist whether linear logic had been invented or not.
What I'm saying is that I could take, for example, your DC category, let's say, mm-hmm. and I could write terms that represent the set, the morphisms, right? And then I could try to model this using, say, some kind of lambda calculus.
And that should give you some sort of lenses, really, if I understand the idea of lenses properly, because, you know,
can you point to some work on this, explaining why this is related to lenses?
No, not yet, but I was hoping to do that this year.
Because some of this looks a little, some of these, you know, the functions that you were showing in this DC construction looks a little like lenses. So what I'm saying is that if you wanted to implement this in a programming language, then you would take those category constructions and transform them into some kind of Cartesian closed category with some twist, maybe, and then we could say, well, this is just some lambda calculus with some extra twist or something.
Well, I think it would have to be something like a linear lambda calculus plus stuff, right? Because you don't want to have a Cartesian closed category, but
but you constructed this you know, with the relation. So you need some things that to do with relation. You need this factor by impose this condition on the relation and so on. And that kind of thing is not present in lambda calculus.
Relations are difficult to open with them is hard. But yeah, no, it's very interesting. We should try to do that. It's not what I was saying that Harley did is very different, because there he was only dealing with the terms that mean, that come from the logic. So they are, what they call it, the initial terms, right? They kind of, if you have any type theory, you have the initial terms that you kind of construct for the type theory, and you have the basic rules of that. Whereas here, as you're saying, taking the relations and constructing them is different. It's a very specific thing. And no, I don't think has been done. I mean, the only thing that people have been, I mean, there was this famous blog post from Julie Hedges in 2017. Lenses for Philosophers is the name. So if you type this.
That's interesting.
Missing an O, but you know, if you type that in Google, you get it's very nice. Kind of, I mean, other people might not understand it, but I think this audience is exactly the kind of people who could read the blog post and understand it, especially now that I've given you a complete description of the nuts and bolts of the constructions and what I knew and what I wanted and how we kind of reverse engineer stuff.
Thank you. Oh,
sorry, Vlad, you're supposed to stop the recording when you get to the...
No, it was an important discussion. So it's good to have. Why not?
Well, because we can't say stupid things in the middle of the...
But once...
I already said stupid things in the middle of the talk. So it's...
We'll see. Once I get the
YouTube
recording...
YouTube will ban you if you say stupid things. They should have a robot that bans your video if you prove an incorrect theorem. So...
So it's like Turing supercomplete robot, right?
Yes. I have a question about a statement at the very early. You said that Dialectica was trying to constructivize hating algebra, I mean, hating arithmetic.
Yes.
But isn't hating arithmetic, if it's intuitionistic, isn't it already somewhat constructive? Or are you talking about getting rid of the quantifiers?
My bad. I meant piano arithmetic. So kind of what I meant
is
that Gödel always wanted to make sure that even when he was talking about classical logic, that it was as close as possible to intuitionistic logic, because he was living in a time where the things were kind of serious mathematicians kind of would go in one direction and serious mathematicians would go in the other direction. So he wanted to be pragmatically true, kind of, you know, I know where I am kind of committing the sin of being classical, which is it's a much more widespread attitude than you'd think. I think lots of people would like to say, okay, I mean, I always said that when I was young, I want the theorem, preferably constructively. But you know, if I can only find it classically, give me my theorem. Later on, we think about how to make it constructive, or if we can make it constructive. And this is all kind of stuff that I read in the collected work. So it's mostly reading between the lines of Professor Troostra's commentary on Gödel's work. So kind of, I'm not a proper philosopher, so you know, maybe there is mistakes on it, but the idea, I mean, that bit is actually true, that that he said that he was going to do it for piano arithmetic, but he's also assuming that that it was enough to do it for Haitian arithmetic, because he could just use his own double negation again. So he did in the Dialectica paper, he did not, I mean, he just mentioned I could use the, but so he does all the stuff for hiking in the paper itself, the paper that, well, I should mention the paper that that I read, which is the one that was translated into English by, what's that? I'm sorry, I can't, I'm failing on the name of the translator now, but there's several versions in the collected work. So, you know, there's several, because he kept rewriting the, I mean that, okay, you gave me the chance just to talk a little bit about this stuff on the philosophical importance or not. Because you see, the way I understand it, which might be totally wrong, but the way I understand it, he was thinking to himself, Gödel was thinking that functionals of N, that they were more understandable than things like the real numbers of or continuous functions or sequences or something like that. Because, because you know, you say to yourself, it's a natural number going to another natural number. That's kind of, this is kind of, I mean, there's the other famous quote about, what is that? The natural number, everything else is man's creation, but the natural numbers God gave us.
I think, was it Dedekind who said that? Yeah.
I think so. So, yeah. You know, I think he was thinking along those lines that the higher order functionals were kind of more acceptable and we could just, that, you know, if we could tame the higher order Kronecker, thank you, Dan, thank you. Yeah, so I think he was thinking that if we could tame a recursion using his notion of iteration in system T, and if we could accept the idea that functionals of natural numbers were kind of more human somehow, more acceptable, then this would be a way of showing that everything was fine, that there is no that the system, that the program of Hilbert actually had found a way out, had found a new lease of life. You know, the incompleteness is there, yes, but we can do lots, you know. But this is all kind of my wishful thinking, perhaps. One of the things that is kind of serious mathematics is the fact that if you go and open the collected works on the page where Trostre is explaining how you pass the two quantifiers, one through the other, because you know, you have two quantifiers, right? You have exists for all, you have to kind of move them to get a single one at the end. So when he's explaining that, Trostre is explaining that, he says, well, look, this is constructive, and here is the only bit that's non-constructive. So he makes this claim that Gödel did use the most constructive way of moving the quantifiers around possible. So that's just mathematics. That's not wishful thinking on my part. But the rest that he thought that functionals were more acceptable. This is a little bit of, maybe I'm trying to read too much into the guys.
All right.
Yeah, thank I didn't you. Put,
yeah.
That, yeah. I not put a little sign on, but yeah, that's
okay.
And you know, it looks like a Spanish name, right? But it's not.
Sichuan, Sichuan.
Bye, Sergey. Sorry,
just. I was looking.
Any more questions or discussions?
So it seems like everybody.
Yes, yeah, one more. Yeah, one more comment, and that is, you talked about the tight hierarchy. And to me, from I'm coming from, you know, computer science background, to me it seems like the problem is not, you know, n into n or, you know, 2 to the n cardinality, but when you say n functions from n to the n, we got to limit the kind of functions. If you don't limit the functions, all functions end to end, that's just too big. But if you limit it to functions that are constructible using, you know, let's say the finite operations and, you know, some kind of recursion, then maybe then that may be more manageable, right? But if you allow arbitrary set theoretic functions from end to end, then everything is, you know, non-constructive.
But he's got that, right? Because Gödel's saying that the functions are all defined by the iterator that he gives in system F.
He does define the language to begin with. Okay.
He does.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, then the stratification, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, okay. No.
I think it's an interesting, from programming language point of view, I think it's interesting how functional languages have gone from simply providing recursion and that's it, to now providing finite operators like fold and map and things like that. So that if you write a program without recursion, but just using fold and reduction and things like that, then you can be guaranteed termination, right? And so you try to limit the kind of constructions you use to make the logic, the proving easier. Whereas if you introduce while loops and general recursion, then yeah, proving termination is non-trivial. So.
Right, yeah. No, but this fact is that the map and fold and stuff like that, they are part of our setup, right? Because they are just mm-hmm. kind of categorical operators in disguise. So they,
yeah,
about them. What is a little bit more complicated is that we have lots of different ways of thinking about kind of partiality and recursion in the setting, and then that is
right.
Not as far as I know, not as well known. Kind of,
mm-hmm.
but
yeah,
more.
Well, you know about the Rust programming language, right?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, so that's a very interesting, you know, real world application of linear logic. And so I think gradually, I think computing is catching up in a to all that theory.
I mean, I am very proud of the fact that my friend Alan Jeffrey kind of did a big song and dance about the fact that Rust was using some of the work that we did that many years ago on linear logic.
So, mm-hmm.
So I do know that they exist. But yeah, the latest thing about Mozilla sending all the guys.
I know, that's another issue, yeah. Okay. All right, thank you.
Not at all.
So I guess we are done, right?
I think we are done. That was very good. Thank you kind of for coping with the long explanations and stuff. I hope people didn't, I mean, people, that's the other good thing. People can just turn themselves off and go and make a cup of tea if they want to, right?
Yeah. Thank you, Valeria. Yep. So, okay, I'm stopping the recording.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.